My name is Neri Leiva Gutierrez, and I am the executive director of NOMA. And we are an arts service organization in Upper Manhattan supporting artists and arts organizations. And we are so excited to be part of this unique and timely collaboration between NOMA and the Columbia University Zuckerman Institute. You are here for our third and final installment for now in our Sound Waves and Brain Waves Performance and Dialogue series, which explores the intersections between jazz, music, and science. And tonight's program, Communicating Through Music, brings together the extraordinary Miguel Zenón, 2009 NOMA Art Stroll honoree and jazz artist in residence at the Zuckerman Institute, and Dr. Daniel Kimmel, assistant professor of clinical psychiatry at Columbia University and himself a musician, both of whom are here today to engage in conversations around science and improvisation and communication through the lenses of art and science. And as we do at NOMA, we would like to extend the conversation to all of you. So as Michelle mentioned, please deposit any questions you may have throughout the evening in the chat room, and we will be sure to give you an opportunity to ask them. But before we begin our program, I would like to introduce Dr. Paula Croxon, neuroscientist and associate director for public programs at Columbia University Zuckerman Institute, who will tell us a bit about the program and formally introduce our evening's featured experts. Paula, so happy you're here.
I'm so happy to be here. Thank you so much, Neria and Michelle, for those lovely introductions. Thank you all for being here. It's so wonderful to have this opportunity to spend time with you. And it's so wonderful to have this opportunity to collaborate with NOMA on this fantastic series. This year, we've been lucky enough to have a jazz musician in residence at the Zuckerman Institute, which is a neuroscience institute located in Northern Manhattan and part of Columbia University. Our jazz musician in residence, Miguel Zenón, has been spending time in the institute with the scientists, and some incredible discussions have arisen out of those interactions. And one of those discussions is essentially what we want to share with you this evening. So without further ado, I'll introduce our participants and let them get on their way. Please join me in welcoming multiple Grammy nominee and Guggenheim and MacArthur fellow Miguel Zenón and assistant professor of clinical psychiatry, Daniel Kimmel, who himself is also a jazz guitar and flute player.
All right, everyone. Thank you, Paula, and everyone. Great to be here. And thank you, Daniel, for taking the time out of your really, really busy schedule. Daniel's just getting off his office hours just to join us today. So thank you for doing this, Daniel. Appreciate you being here. We're gonna talk a bit about music and language and communication. But before we do that, I want to start us off with a little music just to get us warmed up. I'm going to play something also related. Last time I played up. Take the A Train, which was kind of related to us Uptowners. So now I'm gonna play another Uptown related piece. This one's called Harlem Nocturne. It was popularized by Duke Ellington, Ray Noble. Many others have played a little bit of it. Harlem Nocturne.
Thank you.
Music doesn't hurt. So thank you again, Daniel, and everyone for joining us. So Daniel, we've been having all these conversations about music and communication and language. And I guess one of the things that could get us started is you know, all the common features that they that music shares with language, right? When we talk about improvisation and grammar and syntax and all those things that they share in common. And we were having this conversation, so talking about music, and especially about folk music, you know, and how these things, you know, it's one of the, I feel like we kind of share this idea that folk music is this really pure form of music where language just kind of happens, right? Do you feel the same way?
Yeah, absolutely. And well, first of all, do we have to talk? I mean, can we just listen to you for the next 30 minutes? I mean, really, can I get a yes, yes on that, everybody? I mean, Miguel, you are just such a gift, and oh, it's just such
Thank
a
you,
treat.
Man.
I feel like I'm sitting here in my living room just getting serenaded, and why would I want to interrupt that? So thank you. And
thank you
to Paula for the introduction. Thank you to Noma for organizing this incredible event. And for including me, I'm humbled and honored to be here. So thank you all very much. Miguel, as you know, we talk about communicating through music. I think in some abstract ways, we just learned everything from Miguel that we need to know. I mean, it's just in that playing, it's the talent, it's the rigor, but it's also the sweetness, the sensitivity, the clearly a man open to many ideas just in that one solo, drawing from so many different sources. And I think we do communicate a lot through music, even in sometimes very explicit ways. And it's really touching to be included in this and to be having this conversation with you. Absolutely, as you're saying, Miguel, I've had the privilege to talk with you over the last year almost now about music and about neuroscience. And one of the themes we seem to keep coming back to is, what is music doing for us? Why do we have a brain that seems to like music, that seems to like sound? Like, what's up with that? And one of the ideas we keep coming back to is that, well, maybe we have music in the same way that we've got word spoken language, mm-hmm. or that we have, mm-hmm. you know, nonverbal cues, whether that's like on the subway, averting your gaze from like that seedy looking character, or whether that's kind of how bright and eyed and smiley we get when we see an old friend. Like, we have lots of ways to communicate. And I think music fits in with that repertoire. And folk music is one of the places where those things seem to come together, where mm-hmm. music takes on a role both of how it's learned, like language. Folkloric music is often learned organically through exposure, and why it's performed like language. It's there to entertain, but also mm-hmm. to communicate and to educate, to tell a story, whether that's stained glass windows in a cathedral, whether that's a folk song around a campfire, or whether that's some traditional music, as we call it, from a lot of wonderful places that I know Miguel draws from. And you were telling me the other day about how you encounter this kind of in the street music in Cuba, in Havana.
Yeah. Well, I mean, definitely, we were talking about our experiences visiting there and running into music in this sort of pure way, right? And you have your own stories and I have my own stories. But, you know, me being from Puerto Rico, I've seen that in Puerto Rico also, you know, this idea of music being there sort of as a way of connecting and communicating, you know, and you know, I was telling you about this little experience I had in Cuba where we were playing some concerts and you know, after the concert, I was talking to the people in the audience and I realized that, you know, there were musicians there, but there were also, you know, rumberos and dancers and artists and teachers and, you know, engineers and taxi drivers. And it was the kind of thing where like, I felt that music in that sense was being used in the highest way, you know, it has the highest purpose, which in this case was basically to communicate. And it wasn't a thing where like this type of music is only accessible to certain people, or, you know, you got to kind of know these things to get in. It was kind of like just there and people were just connecting to it. And I've seen a lot of that in Puerto Rico, you know, and we were talking about street music. Cause you know, I got to see a lot of that in Cuba and Puerto Rico and a lot of other places, you know, and I actually wanted to play a little sample of something. And this is actually from Puerto Rico. In Puerto Rico, we have this music called plena, and plena is our street, our carnival music, right? You know, our kind of like our mobile, the music that you see in the streets and you see people moving. I wanted to play this little clip from a plenazo callejero, which literally means, you know, people getting like together in a street corner, you start singing some tunes, and then you just kind of like one guy starts a song, another guy starts another song, and they just go on and on. And I think, listening to this, you know, what you get really, besides the music and you know, the call and response, the coro and pregón, this idea of the call and response that's in a lot of African-derived music, you get this energy, right? This street energy where like people are feeding off each other without really talking to each other, just looking and listening and feeding off the language from the music. So I'm gonna play a little of this just to kind of get us started. This should be... This is really nice. Let me see.
El prestamista me está buscando.
Right, so that's the kind of energy I'm talking about, and you know, there's a really, if you saw this live and you felt the energy, you know what I mean. I mean, the people in the audience. I mean, Daniel, I know you've seen a lot of this yourself, but what really gets me from this is this music really just communicating, right? Like just giving you cues, and you hear a drum and you play it and you hear the vocal and you harmonize that, and it's a common language that they're all connecting with, because they all know the same language. And again, these are street musicians, you know, these are not musicians that went to a conservatory, they can't read music, but they just kind of learn by listening and imitating, you know, just the way we learn how to talk, which brings me back to your point, Daniel.
Absolutely. I mean, and just to your point about the energy, I mean, even in our Zoom rooms, I saw all of us kind of shaking and bobbing. I mean, it's infectious.
Hard not to.
And I know we're not going to have time to talk about this tonight, but we don't just communicate through words and through music. We also communicate through our body. And dance is a whole nother level, I think, where something very similar goes on. And those things go hand in hand. You know, earlier you were mentioning the structure. You were talking about grammar and syntax, and it strikes me there's a lot of overlap there with language. I mean, when I'm speaking to you right now, I didn't write this all out. It's improvised, mm-hmm. but it's yeah. playing by a set of rules. I mean, my words have meaning. I can put the word in front of word, but I can't put word in front of the. Like, that doesn't make sense. There's a syntax. There's a grammar. How I got to use a verb, how I got to change that verb, or I got to make changes to those verbs depending on how they're all fitting together. And finally, there's a rhythm. I'm pausing, mm-hmm. I'm breaking. You're listening to that to know when I'm done or when to interject. There's intonation that lets you know it's a question or lets you know it's a statement. And so we're doing all of that really sophisticated in real time, all the time when we're speaking. It's like a jazz solo. And that's what it is. When mm-hmm. we play music, we're doing that same thing. We're drawing on intensely well-developed set of principles, whether they're written down or not, that have been developed, that have just come emerged often organically over the ages to give us what we got, to give us a set of rules to play in. And I think that's right. what lets street musicians who've never met before get together and play music.
Exactly.
Even though it's improvised, it's playing by within a common language. And I think you were talking a little bit about that with like the coro pregón, which we heard at the end of the clip there. This sort mm-hmm. of call and response. I think it's like statement yeah. and question,
yeah,
statement.
Yeah, exactly.
It's improvised. Like the group, they don't have to necessarily agree on what that is, but it's a chance for someone to start to lay down some knowledge, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, no, exactly what it is. When you heard the coro means like the everyone sings the one verse. So it's like the coro is a large group of people, and then the pregón or the soneo would be like the soloist, and he or she they're answering to the coro. So the coro is static, and then the pregón is kind of improvising around a theme, I guess if you will. And again, like I said, this, I mean, you hear this on plena, but you hear this on salsa, on rumba, you hear this on, you know, funk. This is something that's really, really embedded in the music in this part of the world. And it's kind of what drives it, you know, that energy that drives it in many ways.
You know, it's funny you talk about the kind of universal like language that music provides, how this set of mm-hmm. rules really transcends the barriers, the sort of Tower of Babel world that we live in, where we don't all speak the same verbal languages. When I went to Cuba, I went in 2015, and this was just before Obama kind of opened things up, and you had to have a reason to go. So I went under mm-hmm. academic auspices. Somebody put me in touch with the director of the Neuroscience Institute there, so I went to give a talk. But my real reason was to hear the music. And man, like you said, it's just everywhere, pouring out of every hole, every orifice, every bar, every hotel lobby. It turns out every apartment. So check this out. I get there, literally get off the plane, go to what was like, basically like an Airbnb without the air. It's kind of like you just called up some guy who had rented a room in his place. And my girlfriend at the time, my wife now, stayed there. We get into this little courtyard where the apartment is. And before we even get there, there's some other apartment off the courtyard where they're rehearsing. Mm-hmm. They're playing kind of some salsa music. So mm-hmm. I put my stuff down and I grab my flute. I run right there. I go to the door and I just hold up my flute. Like I speak a little Spanish, but not enough to get by like a rapid rehearsal kind of chit chat. And like, they're like, come on in. And they don't have to say anything. They just start playing. You hear the key, you hear the changes. It turns out later I learned they were playing a song called Daniel, like, which is my name, which is just like super coincidental. But like, we just went for it and we made friends and we hung out like me and the guy whose apartment it was, made friends and we hung out the rest of the time there. I don't think you can do that with something else. I mean, music really allowed that to happen.
Now, what's really amazing is that all you had to do was show them the flute. It's almost like that was the secret passcode, the secret password to come in. You just went like, that's flute. It. And they were like, okay, that's it. We're speaking. We're now speaking the same thing, you know, which is it's so great. I mean, what I love about that story is how simple it is to connect, you know, through music. It's like, okay, so now we know that we're in the same song and we can connect, you know, and kind of go into this idea of folklore and also, you know, like here in the States, I mean, you could talk about folklore in many ways. You could talk about jazz as something folklore. You could talk about gospel music. A lot of jazz musicians, they come out of the church, you know, and they learn to play like that at the church. They learn why, you know, by as kids watching the drummer or the bass player and just looking at their fingers, looking at their hands, and eventually, you know, just like learning by imitating the same way we learn how to talk, you know. And there's another example that I wanted to play real briefly. And we talked about this, Daniel, is this amazing drummer from Senegal who passed away a few years ago. His name was Dudu Ndiaye Rose. He was from Senegal, master drummer, right? And there's this recording from 1991 called Djabote. It was recording in this island off the coast of Senegal. And basically it was this guy and Dudu Ndiaye Rose playing with what you could translate to as his family, you know, extended family. So like, you know, he had a few wives. So all his wives were playing, and like, you know, all his children from different generations. He was an older guy by then. So we're talking about 80 plus musicians, all drummers and percussionists and vocalists, really just like speaking this guy's language, which is the best way I could describe it. He taught all of them how to play. He taught them the visual cues. He taught them like when he goes like this or when he plays this, they're supposed to play that. So the result is like you hear this driving force, percussive force, which is actually, if you really think about it in musical terms, is actually really, really advanced and complex music, you know? But they're going at it like talking, like conversation. So let me play a little bit of this Dudu so we can get a feel for what this sounds like. I love this, you know, and this is one of those things that I go back to all the time, this one recording, because it's just so great. So I'm gonna play a little bit of it. So I hear this and I immediately think about, you know, this super advanced marching bands that you see here in some of the southern colleges when they go out and they do the super advanced things. But here the thing is like they're just going by this guy's movements. He goes like this, they just go rugudum-tum, rugudum-tum, tugudum, 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 rugudum-tum. And he goes like that, ra-ta-ta-ta-ta, and they respond. It's like a constant conversation, but it's in a language that he built and he taught them, you know, which is what makes this really deep for me.
Right, and it's not written down. It's not something where they rehearsed like those marching bands did for hours and hours and hours, saying, okay, wait, no, the beat's not there, it's there, it's there. Okay, then we transition here. It's much more fluid. And one of the things that you, Miguel, really fascinates me is how does the brain do that? Like, how does the brain get so precise that it can anticipate, oh, he's gonna move his hand like this, and I have nanoseconds to like adapt to that and play the next beat. And as a neuroscientist, one of the things that's so striking is how crummy the brain is at doing timing at most things. Mm-hmm. If I ask you to estimate how long did it take between this tick and that talk, or if I ask you to replicate an interval for me, we're bad at it. And I thought as we could maybe do a little interactive thing. I don't know if the audience would be willing to participate here. You can like turn cameras on if you're able to turn them on and take your microphones off. And we'll just do like a little exercise to see if we can like time things. So if you guys can do that, is there a way to change the view so that we can see everyone? If not, that's okay.
Yes, there is.
Yeah, just go to your top right and click on view and choose the gallery view.
Oh, there we go.
Anyone who
wants to. Great. Oh, sweet. Thank you. And I know everybody's in different situations, so not everybody can turn on their camera. I don't want to turn on the mic, but if you can, please do. It makes us feel like we're actually in front of a live audience. All right, so to start off, we're just gonna try and clap something. So I'm gonna clap and I want you to clap it back. You ready? So I'm gonna go, ready? Oh, I'm sorry, 1 second. I'm gonna clap twice and then I'm gonna clap again, and I want everyone to clap where that second beat would have occurred. Does that make sense? So we're gonna be like,
so we're trying to anticipate where it's coming.
I'm gonna give you the first clap and the second clap one time. Just listen. And then I'm gonna give you the first clap and you're gonna give me the second clap. You guys ready? Okay. All right, ready? Now we're gonna go. Right, awesome. You guys were like almost a perfect science experiment right there. We just did like exactly what the textbooks say, which is that it's something called Weber's law, W-E-B-E-R. And what Weber figured out was that when we estimate an interval, we have an error on that interval that's proportional to how long the error is. What does that mean? That means if I play an interval that's like 4 seconds long, we're gonna be off by about plus or minus 1 second. If I play an interval that's 8 seconds long, we're gonna be off by like plus or minus 2 seconds. And we just did that like perfectly. That interval was up 4 seconds long, and some people were a little early, some people were close to the middle, some people were really late. That's normal. Like all of our brains are doing exactly the right thing. But now I wanna try and do this again, all right? We're gonna do the same kind of game. Ready? We're gonna do it again, ready? 1, 2, 3, 4. Now stop, ready? And we're gonna do it again. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I want you guys to clap. Perfect, perfect. So now we're all together. Somehow, when we provide a rhythm, when we make it part of a movement statement, the brain does something very different. It's the same brain we got, but we're using it in a different way and quite possibly different parts of it to replicate that same interval when it's done in the context of a rhythm that we don't have access to when we're doing it in the context of just of an interval that's happening devoid of any kind of rhythm or divorced from any kind of music. And that's something, so that's it for the demo. Thank you guys all. You can do a real round of applause for all of you guys right now. Lots of claps, yeah. And that was pretty cool. I didn't know it would work that well, honestly. So I'm pretty excited to see that like the textbooks kind of hold up. So that was great.
Yeah, I was curious to see how that was gonna go. It went well.
Yeah. Sometimes when we say curious, we mean nervous.
Yeah, so, exactly.
So there's another thing, Miguel, that kind of comes up in neuroscience too. So we just talked about how exquisite the brain can be for timing in music. Uh-huh. But it can also be really, when we're producing it, it can be really exquisite in terms of perceiving timing. So one a great example of that is the difference between the sound P and B. So the sound P that starts with the letter P, like Peter, and the sound B that starts with the letter B, like boy. It turns out when you break it down, the components of that sound are almost exactly the same. B comes off the front of your lips, and then there's a that comes from the back. P, B, P. If you all do it, you guys can do it with you can keep your on mute, but just practice a few times. Say P with a P and P, B, P, B, so close. And it turns out when you analyze it, the only difference is 10 microseconds. A microsecond is 1/1,000,000th of a second. It's 1/1,000,000th of that like little numbers that go super fast. Excuse me, 1,000th of the little numbers that go super fast on the stopwatch. Those are milliseconds, and you know, they fly by, you can't even see them. These are microseconds, they're 1,000th of that. 10 microseconds difference between the B, the front of your mouth sound, and the And that 10 second delay is with the difference between a B and a P. And yet we can do it and we can hear it. I should say the brain's currency, the way it sends information, is on the order of milliseconds or tens of milliseconds, like the stopwatch hand. So this would be like trying to time a track meet with a stopwatch that like only plays days, like not seconds, not minutes, not hours. It's like day one. Okay, that runner came in. Oh wait, they both came in on day one. You'd be just like up a creek without a paddle.
Right.
Something specialized happened in the ear to allow us to do this very fine thing when we hear certain types of sounds, language sounds. And I think not just spoken language sounds, but music language sounds. And that's part of the reason I think that it's really worth thinking about music in general, music perception, music expression, music performance, within the context of communication, within the context of language.
Yeah, man, that's so great. Yeah, it's so cool. And it's funny, you know, because it all connects so heavily to music and you know, one of the things that we were talking about, I remember, you know, when we got into this conversation, so we were trying to get into this idea of music as a way to connect into to an identity. Like, you know, for example, one of the things that as a Puerto Rican moving to the United States, and I have family in New York and I visited them as a kid and all that. So I was aware that there was this community over here that was like the community in Puerto Rico, but different, you know? And it was really, for me, it was really revealing to get closer to the community here after being in New York for 20 plus years now. And realize that, you know, one of the things that really helps develop that identity is music, you know? Just like language, or even more than language in many ways, you know, because you can see how, you know, for example, going to, you know, the Puerto Rican parade or the, you know, the fiesta en el barrio, la 116, 116th, when those happened, like, I guess the last one was last year. You see how people are kind of holding to that. You see salsa in every corner and rumba and plena and bomba here and there. You know, it's like a way of saying, okay, so this is part of the connection to that identity, right? And we were having this conversation, connecting it to this idea of music as storytelling, you know, and how a lot of musicians here in the United States, even, I mean, a lot of jazz musicians, but I mean, you could talk about artists and writers, they kind of try to look back, you know, into their ancestors and into African music and Africanism in general, this Afrocentric idea of what their creative process was like, you know. And I know you had a couple of examples that you wanted to play that connected to that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think this is a question that's been driving me thinking, and I know we've been talking about this. It's like, okay, folklore music, that's great. We all like it. Not everyone, a lot of people like it. Actually, sidebar, one of the cool things I think when you go to Cuba, when you go to Puerto Rico, when you go to Brazil, when I've been to Brazil, I don't know everybody, but I go looking for the music. And what's striking to me is I go to the places that are playing what I consider traditional folkloric music, whether that's kind of timba and cha-cha in Cuba, whether that's kind of rumba sounds, or whether that's samba in Brazil. And I expect to find other people like me, tourists who are like rarefied music. But no, it's the kids. They are dancing and jiving. Like, this is the hit music. But that's not the case in the States. You go to a club in the States, you are not hearing traditional folkloric American music. That's not what the hip kids are getting down to. And I've always wondered about that. I've always wondered why did that difference between certainly our country and some other countries? And what does that mean for us? And what does that mean for our connectedness? And what does it mean for our roots? When we think about how does folkloric music then show up in American music today? If it's not done so explicitly, that is by continuing the tradition in a conservativist way, how is it showing up? And I know this is something you think a lot about because you practice it. And it's something that, you know, I think shows up in some powerful ways. And sometimes it shows up in an artistic way. Sometimes it shows up, I think, in a way that's both artistic and a statement about identity, like you're saying in the Puerto Rican TVA, but I think also showing up for, especially in the 60s and 70s in this country, where there was a strong Afrocentric movement and Afrofuturism movement, where we're really thinking about elevating the concept of Blackness in this country and doing so by drawing on what are extremely rich and longstanding roots in Western, Central, and Eastern Africa that often get that didn't get celebrated. And so I want to kind of play an example of that I think comes really, really striking. Some of you may recognize this in contemporary music, but I'm going to play the original example. This is a type of music called hindewu, which is a style of singing and whistle playing, a single note whistle that's found in pygmy music in Central Africa. That's like in the Central African Republic, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Cameroon. And it's often used to signal the return from a hunt. So again, communication. So here we go. Let's see if I can share this. Miguel, give me a thumbs up when it's playing to make sure that like I got the technical side thing working. Mm-hmm. Now you guys can hear that. You can hear actually how difficult that is to play. The polyrhythms are intense. Those beats are not in places that we're used to hearing them. And that was actually recorded by some ethnomusicologists who had traveled there to kind of record that music. And Bill Summers, who's a percussionist, and Herbie Hancock, as many of you guys know, master pianist, heard that and they were like, whoa. And then, so they came up with this. So we could go on forever listening to that. I know, but we got to stop so we can move on. But I mean, to me, it's what's so special about that is it's not just amazing music and it's not just bringing traditional music to the accessible audience with a backbeat that just makes your back break. It's like, it's a statement.
Yeah.
It's like this shit, excuse me, now came from that before.
Yeah, and yeah, it's a connection to a foundation. Yeah, it's a connection to the foundation. Right. Yeah,
that doesn't just show up.
Yeah, yeah, it's the kind of thing like you're saying. It doesn't just show up on music like this. I mean, this is kind of like almost like a progressive, you know, way of seeing it. Even though they're giving us a funky backbeat and all that, I mean, it's still complex. There's some complexity there, you know, but you don't have to go that far. You know, you could look at James Brown, you could look at all kinds of music that has a lot of the same roots and you still find the same things, you know, the same kind of connection to an ancestor, to the language of our ancestors, which I think is what's great about connecting to music and thinking about music this way and thinking about language this way. You know, the way we talk, our accents, the words we use, you know, it's all so connected. Hey, Daniel, I was thinking, you know, because I'm looking at the clock and it's kind of getting about that time. But I did want to get to this one thing that we talked about. With this Duke Ellington example that you had lined up, and this is something that has to do with what also has to do with perception. You know, the way we hear music, and why that is. Why is it that we hear a piece of music, and you know, we can gather a certain amount of information, or it delivers a specific type of message. You know, sometimes that's really evident, like when we hear the street musicians playing with each other and they're kind of speaking the same language, but sometimes it's not. You know, sometimes we might hear, you know, a piece by you know, Philip Glass or Beethoven, and we're getting a certain amount of information that might be totally different than what that composer and that performer had in mind. So I was hoping if you could play, tell us a little bit about this example, maybe play a little bit of it, because I would love to get into it a bit before we open it up for questions.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, it's actually interesting, Miguel, that we've been talking about music as language and we haven't had one example with words.
Yes,
it is. You know, like, we think that would be the obvious place to start, would be a song with words. And words do have carry so much meaning. They diffuse so much of the ambiguity. And Duke Ellington recognized that. For Duke Ellington, music wasn't jazz. I mean, you were telling me this, Miguel. He didn't like it jazz. He was like, no, this is my color palette that I paint the African-American experience. And he wanted to be darn sure that his audience heard that. And one of the most beautiful ways I think he did that, and this man, if you haven't listened to Duke Ellington, you're in for a treat. I mean, just the most beautiful speaker and the most, well, you'll hear it. Goes to London, England, high society, Royal Albert Hall, playing for the Queen. And he says, I'm gonna perform for you. My tone parallel is what he called it for Harlem. And I don't want you just taking your own mind here. I want to paint the picture for you so that when you hear this music, you hear what's in my head. And so here he is. This is Duke Ellington in 1963, I think.
So now Harlem, or rather our tone parallel to Harlem. Harlem, of course, being a place that we've lived very close to and with and have absorbed many of the qualities and quantities of Harlem. It's a wonderful place. Let's imagine we are starting at 110th Street. We're going up toward 145th Street. These are the north and south extremities of Harlem. We start up through the Latin Quarter on up into the 125th Street. And we imagine also that we're on Sunday and we see the people going to church and it's very peaceful and there's a girl, well, hip chick standing on the corner. She stops the traffic. Then we imagine a funeral. And, you know, it's a general atmosphere of every other place in the world. Some happy people, some are blue, some are pretty well off, and some are not too well off. And if you watch closely, you may see us in our civil rights demands as we pound away. The opening statement in Harlem is Cootie Williams as he pronounces the word Harlem.
That's so cool, man. You know, it's funny because, and we had this conversation when you were telling me about this clip, you know, like you said, Duke, he breaks it up for us with language that we understand. So he's speaking English and we understand what he's saying. And he's saying, okay, so you're going to hear the Latin Quarter and then we're going to go up to 125th and you're going to see the church and you're going to see a funeral and you might see us and, you know, you're going to hear this and that. But one thing I was wondering is like, what if we just heard that piece of music with no reference, you know? Like if we just hearing that, like we will probably hear something different. You know, we will probably get a different type of information, different kind of input. We'll react to it differently, you know, because it has a lot, so much to do with the kind of information we've already gathered and kind of going back to that, this idea of language, you know, and that's sort of the way language works. Like for me, for example, English is my second language. So when I learned English, I would learn a couple words and then some sentences and then communicate a little better and then then you can communicate and kind of understand it with something like this, you know, which if we kept listening to this, it will get more and more complex and more involved. But you know, we're still thinking Harlem because he brought us there. Okay, so or even the title, okay, Harlem, there's something about this. This is about Harlem, about some kind of connection. So that's the thing that's interesting to me about this. And one of the most interesting things about music or any kind of artistic expression for me is that it's really subjective, you know? It has so much to do with our personalities, the kind of information we already had. I mean, our mood, the way we feel at that particular moment is just so it's so broad, you know, the many places that it could go.
Yeah, I mean, Miguel, I'm so glad you brought that up. The idea that like how we heard that thing at the beginning shaped, predisposed the way we were going to hear it. What I love about this piece is it turns out that yes, it's a tone parallel to Harlem. It's a story, but it's also a mathematical puzzle. Like when you break down this song, it's a study in threes. It's Duke Ellington exploring the number three. Ba, ba is a minor third. It modulates by a minor third in the second minute. The tempo triples, then it goes to two thirds. The blues note keeps getting that third, that Harlem. Keeps getting played around, goes to a major third. He's exploring this number. It's got nothing to do with Harlem and funeral dances and 125th Street. It's a number. And it's two things at once. It's an expression that's semantic that you can put into words, and it's an intellectual puzzle. And I kind of wanted to ask you about this, Miguel, because when I listen to your music, this is what I experience. I listen to music and I think, okay, yeah, there's a groove there. Oh, that's a Montuno. That's something familiar to me. Oh, yeah. Oh, wait, that Montuno wasn't in four, was it? That Montuno was in five. Like, what's going on here? Miguel, what are you doing? And I experienced this thing that's both folkloric, that's referencing something very familiar and organic, and something that's deeply intellectual. And it hits up both sides of my brain. And I'm just wondering how you do that, how you think about approaching music with honoring both of those halves.
Yeah, no, that's exactly it for me. You know, I mean, I feel that everything that I do is based off some kind of foundation, things that came before me. And I just, you know, I feel that it's my duty as an artist, as a musician to learn this information and study it and make it part of my development, you know, but at the same time, I'm not trying to replicate that stuff. You know, I'm trying to learn from it and learn from the steps that it took that so-and-so artists to get to that point where they became themselves. So I'm trying to follow that road, you know? I was having a conversation the other day with a friend who was saying that he used to play with Art Blakey, this friend is Branford Marsalis, a great saxophonist. And he was saying that, you know, he used to be, like, he wanted to play like John Coltrane. And all he did was listen to John Coltrane records, you know? And then one day Art Blakey, the great drummer, he told him, you know, like, you shouldn't be doing that. If you want to play like Coltrane, you're wasting your time. Like, what would you listen to Coltrane if you want to play like Coltrane? It's like, yeah, but what else would I do? Like, and he said, you know, Coltrane wasn't listening to himself when he was growing up. You know, he was listening to other things. So then he said, okay, so that makes sense. So then he went and started finding out what Coltrane was listening to. And then that took him down this other path, which was like, he was basically following Coltrane's path, but with his own kind of perception, which is kind of my point, is like, you know, I'm trying to get to a point where I'm making my own music and developing my own personality, but based on foundation. And then at the same time, like I've told you many times, like I like things that are intellectual and complex also. You know, I feel that that's something that I'm attracted to just because it's my personality, just complexity for the sake of complexity, you know, just for the sake of being challenged as a listener. And I like that my music has that and sounds like that, you know? So it's kind of like navigating these two songs with something that's very folksy and rooted. And then this other thing that might be a little more intellectual, more brainy, you know?
Miguel, yeah, Daniel, know, this is so wonderful. And I could listen to you talk all night, but I feel sure that we have some questions in the audience. And I wonder if this would be a great time to invite, I know Joanna Castro has been checking out the chat. Joanna, do we have any questions from the listeners?
Actually, Paula, I think it's a great idea. I was wondering if I could ask the first question, if it's okay, because I know this is a thing that a subject that came up in the past. So this is kind of related to your practice, Daniel. I mean, I know that you have a psychiatric practice here in the city, and you know, I was wondering if you could give us a little perspective in terms of how it's been going this year with everything that's going on, and your impression, you know, on how the kind of effect the pandemic has had on folks' emotions and mental health, just kind of from what you've seen through your practice.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up, Miguel, because I mean, we do have to honor this time that we're talking in. And, you know, the interesting thing I think about COVID and psychiatry right now is it's not one thing. I mean, we found this to be true. Remember when this pandemic started and people were like, oh, it's the great equalizer. You know, it turns out it was the great divider. It was the great sort of highlighter of the disparities and separations in our culture. And that's true in psychiatry too. It's not been one thing. It's not, you know, it's not like the person who is anxious about getting sick is now suddenly super anxious about getting COVID. It actually, it's kind of the opposite sometimes. But there are some common threads. I would say the most common thing by far is a sense of isolation, is a sense of disconnectedness and loneliness, a lot of loneliness. And that, I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. We are disconnected. We are physically disconnected. We are soulfully disconnected. I think there's something special that happens when you see someone in the flesh and when you feel them physically, when you hear them, when you smell them. And we're divorced from all that right now. And, you know, it's funny you bring this up in this meeting, because talking about communicating through music, because I think that is one of the special things music does, is it for all of us to clap together. When we did that exercise, we had to get on the same wavelength. I would argue we had to harness the communicative juices that our brain is bestowed, that are built upon a social brain, a brain that's meant to communicate, to jive. And when you listen to music, I believe even if you're not up there performing, you're connecting. You're connecting with that performer. You're connecting with other people in the audience. And I think it's a tragedy we're not able to do that in the flesh now, and not able to do that in clubs and jet and music performance halls. But I do think there's an opportunity to use music in that way now. I went to a live stream of the Village Vanguard, live stream at the Village Vanguard this weekend, and saw Dave Holland Quartet. I mean, amazing, and felt so good. I watched it with other people also on Zoom. We weren't seeing each other, but we felt connected. Mike, our friend Mike Shadlin is there. And I'm wondering, as a professional musician, Miguel, like, what gives? Like, how do you make music? How do you make a living playing music during a pandemic?
Yeah, it's definitely a challenge, you know, especially these days. I mean, a lot of my peers who are mostly gig workers, they're definitely struggling, you know, because what's there, that's stuff like what they're doing at the Vanguard, streams like this one's there, that's still really limited, you know. So it's a rough time. It's a rough time. I mean, I have to say it's a rough time. A lot of my peers are struggling, and you know, they're counting the days, you know, they're counting the days to get back out there. But I also know a lot of people who, even though they're struggling, they're still inspired, you know, they're still at home practicing and writing music and getting ready, which I think is a kind of a silver lining in many ways. Maybe we could take another question. I think you might be muted, Joanna.
Oh, Joanna, are you speaking?
Joanna, do you want to invite somebody to unmute and ask that question?
Oh, Joanna, you're muted, I think. Or maybe not.
We've lost your microphone.
No.
Well, that's exciting. Okay, well, I can see that Alonso had a question very early on. Alonso, are you here? Would you like to unmute and ask your question yourself?
Yeah, hi. Hi, Miguel. Hi, Daniel and everyone.
Hey, man.
You after a long time. It was basically the same thing you touched a little bit before, because we were talking about all this African music and cultural, it's like, what's good about it is this communal sense. But when you write highly complex music, I don't know if you expect the audience, like normal audiences, not musicians, to still feel it And I think you said you did, but do you ever feel like, oh, this is too out for someone to grasp? Or do you ever feel like you have to limit yourself?
Yeah, I guess, you know, as an artist, that's kind of where you have to draw the line. You have to make those decisions, you know, and it's a personal decision. And it says that, you know, you might be going for something that might be like really intellectual or something that's a little less, and you're trying to create this balance. And at the same time, I'm thinking, oh, you know, are people going to like this? Are people going to connect? I don't really necessarily think that way. It's like most of the time I'm kind of like going, okay, so is this the kind of thing that I would like to listen to? Like if I was out there listening, and if it is, then most of the time I go for it, you know, because I feel that beyond anything else that I'm doing, the most important thing for me is to be honest. So I'm not trying to do something just to connect, you know, I'm trying to do something that's honest and hoping that hopefully that will connect. You know, but if it doesn't connect, I don't feel like, okay, so maybe I should change what I'm doing or whatever. I feel like, okay, so if I trust my process and I feel honest about what I'm doing and it still connects with some people, then, you know, that's kind of what I'm going for. So I'm not necessarily trying to tailor it. I'm more like really just trying to make sure that the process is honest. And of course the process involves, you know, studying and like learning your craft and all those things that are not simple things. But at the same time, the idea of putting this out, you know, I just feel that honesty is the principal thing for me. And thank you for your question, man. Gracias.
Awesome. I can see another question here from Z Ramadan. Are you there?
I'm here.
Go ahead. We can hear you.
Unmute.
You okay. Are unmuted. You're good to okay. go.
This question is for Dr. Kimmel. I happen to be Arabic, and no one I know that's from Arabia knows how to say the P sound. So if you were to say New York police, they would go New York police. Mm-hmm. And so I'm trying to figure out that slight sound where you say 1/1,000,000th of a second in pronunciation, how does that affect nations? Does it become genetic over multi-generational, you know, sound issuance? It's curious because then you have people from further East Asia have certain accents and other accents, and they can't say certain letters. And that always intrigued me. And then you have, you know, romantic language can't say the kha, the gha, and the other, you know, Slavic or Middle Eastern or Semitic sounds. And I've always been intrigued. And as an Arab, romantic languages are very easy for me because we have so many difficult sounds. Everything else is very easy to speak. You puede hablar español, yo parlo José, and I can do all of that stuff because I've come from this difficult. So how do those slight differentials become regional internationally?
Yeah, what a great question. I'm really deep and probing. I think what we know is that the brain is like, has certain capacities to learn and to do things. For those capacities to manifest, for those to be operated on, for those to exist in the world, they do have to be refined. They have to be used. And so it is the case for languages, for example, and we actually know most about this in terms of vision, that to see certain things, for a person to be able to perceive that thing, they have to, in their early life, have practiced it, been exposed to it and practiced it. And if they haven't, they may never acquire the ability to do that. Now,
and the best example is Castilian Spanish, right? The tha, tha, za, like it's thenoth. It's not Zenon, right? It's thenon, right?
In Spanish. Yeah, and so I'm so glad you brought that up because I think I'm not an expert in, for example, the difference between P and B around the world, so I don't want to claim anything about that. But my guess is that there's not a fundamental biological difference between people who can pronounce the P or not pronounce the P, but more so a matter of practice and exposure. And like you said, those same people may be able to say sounds or perceive sounds in Arabic, for example, or in different dialects of Spanish that, say, native English speakers wouldn't be able to. That's my best guess, yeah.
So it's basically nurture, not nature.
Yeah, that said, it is fascinating to think about nature. It is fascinating to think about what are there, if there are universal sounds that we all hear and perceive in similar ways? I don't know. So much of it is cultural. I mean, the tritone is a great example of that, the six half steps between two notes, which is dissonant to a lot of people, was apparently, I'm also not a musicologist, so here I am twice kind of overextending myself, but was in fact a common component of pre-Christian music in the West, in Christian, what became Christian nations. But then because of the number six became associated with demonic ideas, like very just much like a conceptual problem, and it got phased out. And now we hear it as dissonant, something that needs to be resolved. So, but it's an interesting question, the opposite. Are there things that are universal? Where we know this the best is in color. Color is remarkable. What you call red and orange and yellow and green are actually cutting up the continuous wavelength of color into lots of little sections. And you have names for them, or in a different language, you have different names for them. But here's the kicker. You go around the world, like 80 different languages, many of them not Western and not until recently influenced by Western culture. Those people have words for those same segments of wavelength. That is, there's something seems conserved across from the genetics, from the nature, that causes us to group different wavelengths into some color that's like red, into other group wavelengths, to some color that's like orange, some other one, something that's like indigo. And it's really remarkable.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your question. Jennifer, I think you also had a question. And then maybe we'll have time for one more after that. Jen, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I was dealing with the unmuting thing. My question actually, it's a interesting follow-on from the Ramadan question, but transferring over more into the music world. As a percussionist, I know that there are differences in the interpretation of a clave rhythm across different countries and cultures. You have versus. And though I'm curious, Miguel and Daniel, what you think about, you know, how those evolved and whether, you know, that's like the nature nurture question as well. And how does one like grow up being ingrained and playing it one way? Can they be flexible and learn to interpret it a different way? Does it depend on what community they're engaging with, and how do they know if they're in a different community to switch to, you know, I guess maybe it's dialect level communication. So I'm curious your thoughts on that.
Yeah, thanks, Jennifer. That's such a great question. And I mean, we could go on this one question. We could actually go on for a little while. But I feel, I mean, you said dialect, but I feel a lot of it kind of going back to Daniel's statement before. I think a lot of it is cultural, in the sense that there are certain ways that we learn, like, for example, that we learn rhythm. And we've talked about this before in the past, you know, in the meetings that we've had, just in terms of how deep we can get within a rhythm. You know, like when Daniel played that example of the hut hunters, boo, beep, boo, beep, boo, beep, boo, beep, boo. So we could just hear that beep, 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 and that could be our hook. You know, or we could hear that would be boo, 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 and that could be our hook. You know, so I think there are so many ways to get within one rhythmic entity, you know, and even within that, we can start talking about like subdivisions and the accents within those subdivisions. As you know, I mean, as a percussionist, you know about all this stuff. So I think a lot of it is the way we learn it, you know, the way it's kind of embedded naturally on us. Like if you're used to hearing music that's really triplety, for example, and you're used to hearing takiti 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 takiti, and most of the music you listen to is triplety and it has that identity, then, you know, when you hear something like tiki taki 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 taki, so that you can feel that because it's in your language. Whereas someone who didn't grow up with that might have trouble. Okay, so what is it that's happening there? How do I relate to it, kind of in terms of how it's connected to stuff that's already familiar to me? So I feel you said dialect, but I feel a lot of it is that, you know, it's almost like language, like learning an accent or learning, you know, having like all these different layers of how you build your musical, you know, your musical language, your musical repertoire in a way. You know, we all have different ways of doing that depending on the stuff that we've been exposed to. That's my opinion.
Exactly. You're kind of saying like potato, potato. Like there's not, you're never going to convince me to say potato. Like you could try it 100 times. I'm not going to be like, oh, that's a nice way of saying it. Like no, I'm always going to say potato. It's so funny if you say this because I was just walking home the other day on Broadway at 142nd Street and set up on a Friday night was this group of people playing with a boombox, playing some salsa music. And then they had some percussion instruments, pass them out and everyone's grooving. Some people are playing clave. You know, some people are playing guiro, some people are playing shikare. And like, I'm got holding the clave and I'm doing like a son clave. Mm-hmm. If that's what they're doing. And I'm like, hey, you guys know rumba clave? And they're like, and I'm like, no, man, it's rumba clave, man. It's rumba. And I was trying to, I was like, look. And they're like, you know, what are you doing? And it was like, it wasn't like, oh, this is an alternative. It's like, this is the language, man. You're not speaking the language. Yeah. Speak the language. Yeah.
That's really cool. Maybe we could take one more question, Paula.
Yeah, let's take one more. I think Rachel asked a question. I know you touched on this a little bit before, but I think this is a great follow-up question. Rachel, are you there?
Yes. Hi. Sorry.
No problem. Do you want to ask your question yourself?
Yeah, sure. It won't let me start the video. But so the thing I'm always interested in is the idea of healing and music and how music can be used to help heal not just individuals like on a physical sense, but also communities. And I think y'all both touched on it like pretty well earlier when you were talking about communication and the fact that music brings people together in certain ways that like we're not being able to experience right now because of everything in the pandemic. And I was wondering what you both thought about how music is going to help us heal, not just as individuals, but as communities and people from this pandemic.
Yeah, so I think Daniel, he touched on this a little bit when he was talking about what he's encountered during his practice. And I feel the same way. I feel that music as a sort of like as a social connection I feel like that's what music is going to do. And I can tell, I mean, the few opportunities that I've had, and there've been very, very few, to play with someone else, with another human being, like in the same room during this time. It's been close to miraculous, I have to say. And it's the kind of thing where like I do that all the time and I kind of take it for granted. But the effect that it had on me, and I'm sure on the other person, and also on the people who are listening either at home or in the venue, or maybe in the distance, you know, if it was like an outdoor thing or something, it's the kind of thing where like it really proves to me the power of this idea of music as an entity for connection, right? Just kind of bringing us together, all in the same, speaking the same language, the kind of thing. And you know, aside from the fact that it's something we might enjoy listening to, or it might relax us, or it might get us dancing or whatever, I think that what it does is really connects us to the person next to us. You know, we're experiencing the same thing at the same time. And I think this is going to be the role, you know, of music and the arts in general, but definitely music. I feel that when we get out there to play, that's what's going to happen. People are going to come out because they want that. They want that connection to the music and the connection to the people who are there experiencing that with them. Do you feel the same, Daniel?
Yeah, I totally second that. I mean, I think we're really talking about the individual level, like what's going to help a person feel better. And I think helping them feel part of a community, helping any of us feel part of a community is going to do that. Music is a way to do that. In my practice, we don't use music per se, but I use a lot of meditation, a lot of guided meditation. There's a lot of rhythmicity to it. And there's a lot of coordination with me in kind of breathing and thinking that I think has a similar quality of feeling connected. But there's part of your question that interests me too, is broader macro.
Oh no.
Cultures who are too.
Oh no, we'll never know.
Music in. Everybody's frozen except me. Does that mean?
I think you're back. I think it was on your side, Daniel. Maybe you want to take a couple steps back and start over.
You're talking about the topics now?
Was there a last thing you heard, or should I start at the top?
No, you were saying that there was a part of the question that really caught your attention.
Yeah, okay. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah. So Rachel, I think the other part of the question is not at the individual level, like what's going to make individuals heal, but at the macroscopic level, like what's going to help cultures heal? Like maybe there's two cultures that don't get along so well. What's the role of music in helping them grow closer? And I don't want to be kind of rose-tinted, star-eyed about this. We have cultural problems. We have gaps. We have chasms because they're hard problems. And there isn't something that's going to come to be like, oh, everybody loves each other. But take that example in Cuba. Like I went to Cuba already freaking admiring the hell out of Cuban music and Cuban people by extension. So there was no gap. But if there were, how in the heck would that continue after that experience? After you play music with someone, after you share in this personal but accessible thing. It's not going to be easy though. Like Herbie made that record in the 70s. Are we all like, oh wow, we should like all like exalt, you know, African art and African traditions? No, it's still called primitive art. It's been moved into the loop. And so we're not there yet. But I do think once you share something beautiful with somebody, it's hard to deny their humanity.
Yeah, that's very cool, Daniel.
Amazing. Thank you so much, everyone who asked the question, and both of you, Miguel and Daniel. Miguel, yeah. are you maybe gonna play?
Yeah, maybe we'll close it up with more music. Before doing so, Daniel, man, this has been so great. Time just flew by, and I'm looking at the clock. I'm like, man, where did the time go? We had all this stuff that we wanted to talk about. We're like, man, we're gonna get to all this stuff. It was great, great having you here, man. So insightful and so great. And thank you all for being here. Thank you, Neria, and the whole team. It's been amazing.
It's been such a blessing. My we've been here, we've been so long. My headphones ran out of juice. So. It's just such an honor to be here and really to be listening to you, Miguel, and to be able to chat with all you guys. You guys have been an incredible audience. I would stay here all night and scat shop. So we're here until we're not. We'll let Miguel take us out.
Cool. So I'll close it out with a little music. This is something written by one of the true masters of our time, the great Dizzy Gillespie, and this is called A Night in Tunisia.
The
Daniel and Miguel and Paula, and to all of you. There was so much food here for the brain and soul. Truly, I feel so full. Thank you. That was really extraordinary. And thanks to all of you. Those questions were just fantastic, so insightful, so thoughtful, and really just wonderful conversation. I feel like we could go on for so much longer. But we to close out the evening, and before we do that, I'd like to quickly introduce Martin Collins, who is our Art Stroke coordinator, who is here tonight. He's going to close out with a few announcements for all of us as we sort of enter into the final stretch here of 2020. So Martin, would you join us?
Yes, thank you, Neria. Thank you, everyone, for joining us this evening. A couple of exhibits and events that are uptown we want to tell you about and view at the Dyckman Farmhouse Museum. Unspoken Voices, Honoring the Legacy of Black America with six artists. You can see the DyckmanFarmhouse.org website for more information. At Morris Jamel Mansion, COVIDA, Homage to the Victims of the Pandemic, new outdoor public art exhibit by Andrea Arroyo. See MorrisJamel.org for information. Three events that are coming up tomorrow, December 15th at 2 p.m., Columbia University's Zuckerman Institute and the National Jazz Museum in Harlem presents Music on the Brain with Miriam King, a master's candidate at Teachers College. See ZuckermanInstitute.columbia.edu for more. And a couple of events uptown as well. January through January 3rd, the Classical Theater of Harlem presents Free, a Christmas Carol in Harlem on their website, cthnyc.org, and a Christmas Carol filmed at the United Palace by Tony-winning Broadway director Michael Arden. See onthestage.com at the United Palace website for more. And finally, the Northern Manhattan Arts Alliance is taking a brief holiday break, and we will return early in the new year. Please see our website, nomanyc.org, for info. A very happy, healthy holiday season to everyone, and best wishes to you all for a healthy and happy new year.
Thank you so much, Martin. And thanks to all of you. And Paula, did you want to say one thing here? I think you might have an event tomorrow you might want to mention.
Actually, Martin already mentioned it.
Oh, I did.
It's tomorrow. It's 2 p.m. It's a lunchtime event for us on the East Coast. With Helen Sung, Miriam King, just tune in on Facebook or YouTube at the National Jazz Museum of Harlem if you want to join that. Wonderful. It's been such a pleasure to collaborate with you at NOMA, with Miguel, Daniel. Thank you so much again.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody. We wish you, as Martin said, a wonderful holiday season, and stay healthy. We'll see you all in the new year, 2021. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.
Good night.